Penguin Random House Audio presents The Romanov Empress, a novel of Tsarina, Maria, Feodorovna, by C.W. Gortner, read for you by Katharine McEwan. Fame and misfortune live in the same courtyard. Russian proverb. Part 1, 1862 to 1866. The Yellow Palace. She comes, the Maid of Denmark, to be our Queen of Love. Martin Tupper. Chapter 1. We should dress alike, I said, on that afternoon when life changed forever. I didn't yet understand how profound the change would be, but I could feel it as I sat riffling through the heap of boxes sent by Copenhagen's and London's finest emporiums, packed with satin-bowed shoes and beribboned hats, silk undergarments, dresses, corsets, shawls, leather gloves, and cloaks made of fine cashmere or Scottish wool. Alike, standing on a footstool as Mama and her maid flapped about her, lifting items to her face and slim figure to determine which best suited her, my sister Alix regarded me in bemusement. As if we were twins? Yes. I tilted up two of the boxes beside me on the settee. Look, you have an extra pair of everything now. We could dress alike and see if your fiancé can tell us apart. Alix's thin brows knit together. Her little frown pleased me. It showed my sister was not as immune to the absurdity of the situation as she might feign. Before she could reply, however, our mother issued her tart reprimand, with that faint irritation she employed whenever I did or said something inappropriate, which for her was becoming all too frequent. Minnie, that is enough. Dress like twins, how absurd! Mama clucked her tongue. As if His Royal Highness the Prince of Wales were blind. Why, you and Alix are nothing alike. Are you certain? Though I meant to sound nonchalant, I heard the challenge in my tone. We might not be alike, but he's only met her once. He might not even recognize her when he sees her again. Mama went still, a ruffled petticoat in her hands. Looking at that creamy white silk, I had to swallow a surge of anger. Times past, we could never have afforded such a petticoat, or indeed any of these other fancy things littering the room. We made our own clothes, and mended them too. We'd been happy in our little yellow palace in Copenhagen, relishing summer outings to swim in the sea, our gymnastics competitions, and musical evenings after frugal meals, where we'd served ourselves at the table. Luxuries had never mattered, not when we had one another. Our family was our greatest gift. Yet here we were, smothered in visible proof of our impending dissolution. How could so much have changed in so little time? Of course His Highness will love her, said Mama. It's his duty as her husband, as it is hers as his wife. Whatever has come over you, to be so contrary on the very day of Alex's fitting for her trousseau? Can't you see she's nervous enough as it is? My sister watched me from the mirror. If she was nervous, she did not show it. She looked tired and pale, the shadows under her cool grey eyes betraying her fatigue. But she was composed, so much, in fact, that her steady gaze unnerved me. Despite her unflinching stance, she must realize I spoke the truth. It was impossible to predict if her marriage would bring her happiness or heartache. But she'd never admit it aloud, not before our mother, who'd laboured so long for this elevation in our fortune, the latest in a sweeping tide of change that had left me feeling stranded, struggling to stay afloat. I was only saying, my voice trailed off as Mama gave me a glare. We know what you were saying, Minnie, and I tell you, it is enough. Exasperated, I crunched the tissue in the hat box beside me. Perhaps I should go out for a walk, I muttered, seeing as I'm not needed here. If you cannot make yourself useful, yes, you should. Mama turned back to my sister. Fresh air will no doubt improve your mood and take that unpleasant sting out of your tail. I'll not have you distracting your sister with nonsense when we've so much to do. Fresh air and a minimum of nonsense were Mama's solution to everything. She was nothing if not sensible. No matter that in the last year, we'd experienced enough upheaval to turn any other sensible woman's head. But Louise of Hesse Castle never indulged such weakness. She'd first showed this obdurate trust in her own judgment by defying her family to marry my father, her second cousin, Christian of Glücksburg, an impoverished princeling of no particular account, with whom she'd settled into a penurious but pleasant existence, raising us with a sensible disregard for pretension. She might now be poised to become Queen of Denmark, with Papa's surprising inheritance of our childless king's throne, while preparing to send her eldest daughter off to marry Great Britain's heir, yet she approached these monumental tasks as she might the daily cleaning of the parlour. And that sting in my tail, as she called it, confounded her, for it was something no child of hers should display, especially in light of our newly exalted circumstances. Tugging at my voluminous skirts, I marched to the door, pausing there. I hoped my sister would call me back. I wanted Alix to say something, to show she still needed me. But when she remained silent and I glanced defiantly over my shoulder, I found her smothered in the silk petticoat, Mama ordering the maid to fasten her stays, as if Alix were a doll. Or a lamb for the sacrifice. To me, my sister's upcoming marriage was much the same. We were not born to grandeur. Mama had often reminded us of this in our childhood, so we wouldn't expect more than we had. Those born into riches are not so fortunate, she would say, as she sat with Alix and me, instructing us in our embellishment of homemade bonnets or darning of underclothes. Those who begin their lives with everything cannot appreciate the rewards of aspiration. Wise advice, for no one had reaped more reward in aspiration than Mama, but scarce comfort to me now as I traversed the Bayernstorf Palace, passing statuary and mirror-panelled walls without a glance, my heels echoing on the parquet floors, and my wide hooped skirt soughing in my wake. We'd moved to the palace a month ago, once it was determined that Papa would become Denmark's new crown prince. Nestled on spacious grounds outside Copenhagen, the palace was suitably elegant, much larger than our yellow home within the city. The beautiful gardens were one of the few changes I'd welcomed, with their magnificent lime trees and walking paths. My younger brother, Veldemar, and little sister, Chira, loved it here, let loose to dirty their feet and scramble under the hedgerows. But I was nearly 15 now, too old for childish games, though as I escaped into the garden I wished I were not. I longed to be a child again, free to run and hide. Raising a hand to my brow, I realized I'd forgotten to fetch a parasol or hat. I risked getting too much colour. Imagining my mother's reaction to this, I strode forth, thinking I should also undo the scratchy net confining my thick curls at my nape and incite a scandal. Only there was no one here to be scandalized. The garden stretched before me in verdant emptiness, until I neared the Swedish-style villa that served as a tea house, and saw a familiar figure in a dark suit pacing outside it, cigar smoke drifting in a cloud about him. Papa. Grasping up fistfuls of my skirt and not caring that my ankles showed, I raced across the lawn to him. He turned, startled, smoke curling from his mouth under his impressive new mustachios. He had grown them to appear more distinguished. I found them funny, for his wispy brown hair was thin on top, a sparse fleece offsetting that thicket on his face. And future king or not, he still had to smoke outside, because Mama deplored the smell and had begged him to cease indulging that disgusting vice. "Finish so soon?" A smile lightened his careworn face. It hurt me to see that he too had begun to change. Ever since it was decided he would succeed our ailing king, Papa had shed his light-hearted air, as if the burden of the crown already weighed upon him. Not for hours, I should think. I wrinkled my nose at the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.